Good. Well, there we are. We are awake. We are here. Good morning, everybody. Hope you are doing well. My name's Matt. I'm one of the pastors here. Take a few minutes. Get up. Say good morning to somebody, maybe somebody you don't know. Ready? Go. All righty, go ahead and find a seat. Glad you made a new friend. Sorry to cut you off. We all get to be here afterwards too, so just hang out. I'm sure there's still going to be snacks in the kitchen, so grab a snack later. Talk to somebody that you just met, get to know them. We're so thankful that you're here this morning. If this is your first time, we'd love to get to know you, and so there is a card in the seat pocket somewhere around you that says Get Connected. Go ahead, fill that out, put that in one of the boxes in the back, and we will reach out to you so that we can become best friends, okay? So that card is your golden ticket to best friendship. So go ahead, fill that out. A few announcements this morning. First, I want to give an update. We didn't give this last week because it was Memorial Day weekend, but an update from our annual meeting. It's a very important meeting for all our members. During our annual meeting, we had several things that we voted on. We have 10 new members. Woo! We are so excited about that. So That happened. Everybody got voted in. Joel Johnson got voted for a few more years onto the board. And then Josh Kelly is now a member of our spiritual board as well. He's got 1 year probation. That's how that works. But yeah, so that happened. So I wanted to give you guys an update on that. Three things that are coming up that you need to know about. The first one is that if you volunteer here in any capacity, we love you, you're amazing, and we want to celebrate you. So on Saturday, June 18th, we are holding a party here in your honor at 5:30, right where you're sitting right now. So again, if you volunteer in any capacity, we want to celebrate you June 18th, 5:30. We just need you to RSVP so that we can get you a wonderful meal. You can either RSVP personally with me, or online at our events page at our website. Other thing is, since we're heading into summer, VBS is right around the corner. If you have little ones, it's going to be July 18th through the 21st. You can sign up online or with Pastor Joshua. Pastor Joshua also needs some volunteers for many, many different things, from food to crafts to teaching. So if that's something that interests you and you want to learn more, go talk to Pastor Josh. He will give you the rundown. The last thing you need to know is that the church family camp is also right around the corner at the end of July, July 27th through the 31st. The last I looked, there was 7 or 8 spots left. Is that right, Sandra? Yes. There are only a few spots left, so if you want to come camping with us any number of those days at the end of July, that sign-up is out in the lobby as you're heading down the hallway on the left, or online at our fbcjc.com/events. You'll find it there. But those spots have gone fast, so make sure you claim that today. We had an amazing weekend with the food truck rally. How many of you came? Woo! Thank you. Even though it rained, even though it was blustery, it was wonderful. It was so cool to talk to so many people, a number of our neighbors across the street, and just friends from the community. So thank you to all of you who came out. I don't have a number yet of what we raised for Fortify in Faith this weekend because we're waiting on just a couple vendors to tell us what they're donating. So we will share that with you next week. But I'll tell you where it's at right now. God did something amazing because we did not think that we would get the turnout that we did with all the rain, but it is very comparable to last year when it was nice and sunny. So we are very thankful for that, but we will give you that number next week. So with that, again, we're not passing plates or anything. There are boxes in the back or to the side. Thank you to all of you who continue to help us spread the gospel here in Junction City and around the world. Because God loves us, we want people to know his love. We want people to know, show, and share Christ's love. That is what we do here at First Baptist. And so we thank you for all of you who have partnered with us to do just that. We're going to pray over our offering. We also want to lift up Meredith Skiller. We want to pray for Ruth. We want to pray for the Parmenters. We want to pray for Carrie Bennett. A number of people that I'm not going to mention just because they'd rather not announce it. But we have people that are going through health issues, family and friends that are facing financial struggle. But we have a big God who can do big things. So we're going to bring our family and friends before him, and we're going to enter into worship. So let's do that. So, Father God, we thank you for who you are. Thank you that you're not a tiny God. You're not an insignificant God. You are a big, mighty, and powerful God. You hear us. You hear the things that are heavy on our hearts. So, God, we pray for Meredith, for Ruth, for the Parmenters, for Carrie, as they face these health struggles right now. God, I pray that you would do a miracle in their lives, that you would heal them, that you would bring your encouragement and your joy back to them. God, for all those that we haven't mentioned, those that are sitting and listening to us right now that are hurting and needing you, they need to know that they have hope. Would you give them hope? God, we pray over our offering that you would multiply it today so that more and more people would know that you are God, that you love them, that you love them so much that you gave up your life for them. Thank you, God. In your holy and mighty name, amen.
We want to welcome you again this morning and invite you to stand as we begin our worship.
Nothing worth more that will ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, Lord. I tasted and see of the sweetest of loves, when my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. Your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is worth. mustard and seed, but the sweetest of loves, when my heart becomes free, and my shame is undone. Your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, what our hearts long for, to be overcome by your presence, Lord. Your presence, Lord. Let us become more aware of your presence.
The beggars.
in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. Won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your
Would you pray with me? Heavenly Father, I just thank you so much for your word. I thank you so much that it is the promise. You have promised us that you will return one day to take us all to be home with you. And Father, that is our hope. That is what gets us through the hard trials that we face. Father, it feels like every day in the world around us, it just seems to be falling apart and crumbling. And God, I'm just so thankful for the reminder of that song that we can stand on your promises, that you can give us the strength and endurance that can only come from you to face what life brings us, that we cannot fall if we are leaning on you, Father. Be with Pastor Ted today as he brings us a message from your word about knowing who you are. Father, prepare our hearts. And God, as we pray every week, and I hope it doesn't just become the mundane, Father, I do pray that we are going to be different today when we leave this room because we've encountered you today. And we ask all this in the name of your son, Jesus. Amen.
Well, good morning. There we are. Can you hear me? No, there we are. All right. Hey, Glad you're here today. If you missed the food truck rally, you missed some great food, and great thanks to, just a boatload of people, Cindy and Matt and Sandra and Josh. They just did a ton of work for that to happen. It was a great opportunity to reach out to our community as well as our own church family. But hey, this morning, I'm just going to start with a story that I probably shared some time ago. It was my first year when I went to college, Western Washington University. They had a student orientation for new students, and I didn't go to the orientation because that'd be boring. So I didn't go, and so, you know, I just started taking classes, really no rhyme or reason why I was taking these classes. I just thought, well, you know, they said that a bunch of people were taking this basic algebra course that was supposed to be really easy, and I thought, well, I don't want to do that. I've had algebra. I'm going to take trigonometry. That'll be a little tougher, and so I struggled through that. I took advanced chemistry because I had a couple of friends that were going to be dentists, neither of which became dentists. So I took advanced chemistry, even though I just got a D because my instructor was nice in high school chemistry, not even advanced chemistry. So I ended up dropping that class to the instructor telling me, you need to get out of this class because you have no clue what you're doing. And so then I signed up for advanced biology. I just couldn't take basic biology. I don't know why. I just thought I was advanced, I guess. And I got a D minus out of that one, so that was a special time as well. And, you know, at the close of my first year, I remember sitting in my room with my roommate, and his girlfriend was there, and they were talking. They were really excited because, man, we've got half of our GURs out of the way. And I said, what's a GUR? I don't know what that is. And they said, well, it's general university requirements. You have to have 2 years of these, you know, for your college thing. And I said, what? I never knew about those. They did those in orientation. Oh, okay. Well, since I did know that, I came to understand that I needed classes. Some of my classes didn't apply. A trigonometry, that basic algebra went towards GURs. Trigonometry did not. It was considered an elective. Woohoo! So that was special. But you know what? Once I came to know that there were GURs, it changed how I approached school. It said I had a purpose now. I had a direction because I knew what was required of me and what was needed for me to graduate. So I started taking classes that actually were helpful to me and classes that I didn't always bomb out of, usually. And so that was a good thing towards getting my college degree. Now, I believe, all this has a point, is I believe that many Christians today across America in the church are often clueless as to what God's GCRs are, general Christian requirements. So often I find people don't know, people have been in the church sometimes for a long time, don't know the basics of their faith. They don't know what they believe. They don't know why they believe it or how what they believe would apply to their daily lives. We're just going through. They like me in my first year of college, they kind of flounder about. They'll go to church, they serve here, they may give there, but they really don't know why they're doing all this. It's just because. Now, certainly there are people here that that's not the case. There's people here who know what they believe, why they believe it, understand it, or living it out, and praise God for that. But, you know, we still need to know and be continually reminded, I think, as believers, of the basics of the faith, of the GCRs, of those foundations that we need to know about and hang on and allow to change our lives. Knowing the truths of God gives us confidence. Knowing the truths of God helps us to, in our relationship with God, it also increases, I think, our praise and wonder of God. We understand who God is and what he has done. We just go, this is incredible what God has done in my life or in the lives of our people. And so in order for us to know what we believe, why we believe it, we're going to start a new series this morning. It's going to be, I don't know how many weeks, 12, but it might be a little longer than that, depending on how things go. But it's called This I Know. It's a This I Know series. I was praying for what God will have us next, and I was looking at different Bibles, books of the Bible, and I was driving my car one day, and it said, Jesus loves me, this I know. And I thought, what is it we know? And so I went and looked at all the verses that say, we know this, we know this, we know this. I thought, this is a series we need to do. We need to know. Here's things that the Bible says, you need to know this. Don't you know this? And so that's where we're headed. I think this series will be relevant to anybody. If you've been a Christian for a long time, you're a baby Christian, you don't know anything about Christianity, I think this will be a helpful study and one we need to be, again, reminded of. In 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 12 to 15, it says this. It says, I'll read it here. Therefore, Peter says, I will always remind you about these things, things that God's given you, what you need to believe, how you're supposed to grow in your faith, how you hopefully can walk into eternity with living it out. I always remind you about these things. Even though you already know them and are standing firm in the truth, you got this stuff, you've been taught, and it's only right that I should keep on reminding you as long as I live. For our Lord Jesus Christ has shown me that I must soon leave this earthly life, so I will work hard to make sure you always remember these things after I am gone. And so that's kind of the aim of our series. We're going to help and remind us of the truths we should know that we might live them out. And so that's our intro for our series. So this morning, this is our This I Know. This I Know is the Bible is God's Word. And you're going to hear this over and over again, and sometimes you're going to say it with me, because you're going to leave here at least knowing that the Bible is God's Word. This is a GCR number one, General Christian Requirement. You need to believe the Bible is God's Word. And there's two key passages, and I'm going to share these passages again and again. One of them is 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16. And this is just the very first sentence of verse 16. So we'll cover 2 Timothy next week, okay? But then the next passage is 2 Peter chapter 1. 20 and 21. You need to look at the context of that. Today we're just looking at 20 and 21. These are two key passages. So when you leave here today, you're going to say, what the Bible is, what do we know? We know this I know, the Bible is God's Word, and two key passages. One is going to be 2 Timothy 3, 16. The next passage is going to be 2 Peter 1, 20 and 21. So I can tell you the Bible is God's Word. And you can go, well, yeah, of course, I believe the Bible is God's Word, but how do we know that? What can we point to? How can we say to someone, hey, this is how I know that the Bible is the Word of God? How do I know personally that the Bible is the Word of God, not just myth or fable, something that's made up comparable to any other book or novel that we might come across in that way? We're going to look at that and say, here's some things that we can say knowing that the Bible is the Word of God. How do we know this? I'll give you several reasons we can know. One is we know the Bible is God's Word because the Bible says so. And you might think, well, that's kind of circular reasoning, but it's just important. It says so, you know, repeatedly. Over 50 times it says God said, or thus saith the Lord, over 50 times. There's other references along that line, hundreds of times, that credit the Word to God. In dozens of places that calls itself the Word of God. And in 2 Timothy 3:16, it says all Scripture is inspired by God. How much of Scripture is inspired by God? It says all. It's all Scripture, okay? And so that's important to understand. It says all Scripture is inspired, and when we see inspired, it's not inspired in the biblical sense. It's a unique definition. In the biblical sense, it isn't inspired in the sense of someone's inspired to write a song, you know? Someone's inspired to write a poem or a book or something. Inspiration here is literally like God breathed. All Scripture is God breathed. We're not talking the writers themselves. It's the words that have been breathed out by God through these different authors. Okay, and so it's inspired in that way. And so the whole Bible, every word originates from God. We look at our next passage, 2 Peter 1, and it says, Above all, you must realize, NLT, you must know. That's a close to the Greek, is you must know. That's where this passage came from. This is the starting passage of this. You must know, ESV, New American Standard, says you must know that no prophecy in Scripture ever came from the prophet's own understanding or from human initiative. No, those prophets were moved by the Holy Spirit, and they spoke from God. So the Bible is a product of God himself, okay? This is not just human ideas. Let's come up with a plan here and let's write something about that. It's from God through people that the Word of God has created. It's important to realize that the writers are not just mere writing machines. They're not like punched like a keyboard and God punched things. He didn't dictate the Word of God to them exactly. This is how it goes. Somehow miraculously through God working through the instruments of human people and their personalities, He guided and controlled what people, that's what we believe here, it's important to understand, He guided and controlled what people wrote, so what was written was what He desired. It's this dual authorship, divine and human, that come together to come up with the Word of God. Now, when I hear that, when you hear that, you explain that to someone, you say, well, that's really hard to swallow sometimes. That's where the Word of God comes. How can I believe that God worked through the instrumentation of people to the point where they would write the Word of God. We can take that. Well, you look at the Deuteronomy 29:29, the mysteries belong to the Lord. Can I explain this? I can't explain this. It's not something we can grasp, but you take the whole of the Christian faith and say, how was Jesus born of a virgin? You know, how did Jesus live a sinless life in that way? How did Jesus become God in the flesh? Emmanuel, God with us in human form. How do we explain that union of God, the God-man? How do we explain how someone came from death and came back to life? These are all foundational, essential Christian truths that we have to hang on, and our faith clings to these truths, and otherwise it collapses. And so, can I explain how this works? I can't. I know it has to be true. It has to be true. Like the resurrection has to be true. Jesus has to be fully God, fully completely God, fully man in that way. Has to be true. Okay. Otherwise, our faith collapses. And so, you say, well, the Bible says it's the Word of God. Is that our only evidence? And say, no. There's more we can point to. You look at how Jesus affirmed the Scriptures. The Bible's God's Word because He affirmed the Scriptures. We see He quoted Scripture as authoritative. And you think about in different instances, but one of those was when He was tempted in the wilderness, if you remember, by Satan in Matthew chapter 4, 1 to 11, and Luke chapter 4, 1 to 13. Satan tempts Him three different times, and what does Jesus respond with three different times? It is written. It is written. It is written. He quotes Scripture. He takes it's been twisted sometimes by Satan, and He says, no, this is what it says. You know, so he's affirming that the Word of God is true, and it is God's Word. In Matthew 5:18, Jesus says, I tell you the truth, until heaven and earth disappear, not even the smallest detail of God's law will disappear until its purpose is achieved. It's not going to change. It says in Matthew 15:6, he declares the Word of God is the Word of God. And we go on to another passage. I'm giving you a lot of passages, a lot of information from, these are from various resources. I'm just pull them together here to help us in this deal. In John 10:35, Jesus said, and you know, there's our word again, you know, not you think or maybe wonder, this is possible, you know that the Scriptures cannot be altered. Scriptures cannot be broken. This is Jesus speaking about the Word of God. So the Bible says the Bible is the Word of God. Jesus affirms that by His use of the Word of God. We know the Bible is God's Word because of its unity, okay? You think about this, the Bible is said to be written approximately over 1,500 years, okay? You have 66 books in the Bible. If you didn't know that, there's 66 books. And they're written by 40 authors, give or take, okay? 40 authors, 66 books, different time zone, different time frames, different personalities, different cultures, different experiences, diverse writing styles. They're writing with different genres. Some are writing poetry, some are writing narrative, some are writing personal letters, some direct theology, and yet all over all that time, all those authors, all those different genres, it points to one theme, and that is God's plan for salvation of his people in that way. It's an unchanging focus with all these diverse backgrounds. It can only be divine. How can else you can explain that all these things come together to point to Jesus, to point to God's plan for salvation over that long period of time? It's just impossible. It's impossible in that way. Here's a fourth reason we know the Bible is God's Word, because fulfilled prophecy. Fulfilled prophecy, I mean, there's the accuracy and number of fulfilled prophecies is really incredible in that way. And you, just for an example, you point to Jesus being the anticipated Messiah. There's several different prophecies, and these are talking some sort of centuries ahead of time. You know, his birth in Bethlehem was prophesied in Micah 5:2, 700 years, I believe, was before fulfilled in Matthew. We go on, and it says we have his genealogy, if you will, his ancestry. It comes through Abraham. It comes through tribe of Judah. It comes through King David. All those prophesied, all those fulfilled in that way. There's specific details about Jesus' suffering and his death from Isaiah 53 fulfilled, and all the Gospels fulfilled what was prophesied in Isaiah. And you know, the likelihood, mathematicians say, the likelihood of one prophecy being fulfilled is just astronomical. but you take all this multitude of prophecies and put them together. I mean, the zeros wouldn't fit on our screen probably. How the lack of probability of happening is incredible. And so it's an affirmation that the Bible is God's word through all these prophecies being fulfilled. Let me give you one last evidence, if you will, that the Bible is God's word. And this is subjective, I'll admit this, but this is that lives are changed, because a lot of belief systems can say, well, lives are changed this way or that way. So you got to be careful with this one. But it is a reality that we can say, you know, the Bible is God's word because of life change. Hebrews 4:12, for the word of God is alive, is living and powerful, living and active. It is sharper than the sharpest two-edged sword, cutting between soul and spirit, between joint and marrow. It exposes our innermost thoughts and desires. I mean, anyone who's been a Christian for any amount of time is going to say, there was a time when I was reading the Bible, I heard the Bible proclaimed in a Bible class and a sermon, and God just struck me. I mean, convicted me of something. I needed to ask forgiveness. I can give you example after example after example. We could share in this room the time that happened for you. And we just go on and on. You know, person says, I was abused by this person, and I was angry and bitter towards them for years, but God convicted me, and I forgave them and was set free from that anger that I had. This isn't me, but a story, okay? Person been in jail several times. Hard life, comes to know Christ through hearing the word of God, is transformed, kind, warm, passionate, faith for Jesus in that way. Person who's involved in crimes, immorality in all kinds of forms, hears the word of God and just says, that's what I want. I want to know Christ. I want to know if God's forgiveness is totally transformed their life. I mean, we just go story after story. It's the life change that comes through knowing the word of God. So we should be able to say with confidence, we know this. We know the Bible is word of God, God's word. Key passages, 2 Timothy 3, 16, second passage, 2 Peter 1, 20 and 21, okay? We're going to hear this. I want you to walk out here knowing that. Someone asked you, how do you know the Bible is the word of God? Well, I know it is because these things, you may not remember all these points, but you can say, here's a couple of verses I can point to, and it'll give you confidence in that way. So knowing the Bible's the word of God, what are the implications for you and for me in our lives? Okay, that's good. The Bible's the word of God. Thank you. Does it stop there? It doesn't stop there, okay? But knowing the Bible's the word of God, it tells us some things about the Bible. One is the Bible in its original form was without error. I mean, it's called inerrancy, which means it had the prophets and the apostles were inspired original writings and included no errors. It's important to understand that the inerrancy and inspiration go together. The words were inspired by God, and so since they came from God, they had to be without error because God cannot lie. It's impossible for God to lie in that way. That's the word of God tells us. So it's mistake free, and because it's inerrant. That's the product of the inspiration, if you will, as the inspiration is the process in that. Now, some may ask, well, okay, so the original texts were inspired by God, but what we have today, were they inspired by God? Say, no, he didn't re-inspire the text that we have. And so people will say, well, why should I follow the Bible today as we have it? Because it's got mistakes in it. And so can I really trust the Bible in that sense? And there are, now how they can point this out, I'm not exactly sure, but they're saying, you know, with the textual criticism, the inerrant original can be reconstructed over 99% accuracy. Now there's certain things, since we don't have the originals, on how they can say that it's that accurate, but we do know that what we have is in essence the word of God. There are some challenges in certain ways, but we find that, again, God cannot lie, scripture cannot be broken. Inerrancy is an anchor for our faith. If we have an errant Bible, then we pick and choose what we believe and don't believe. And there's belief systems that say, well, we believe the Bible as far as it is correctly translated, okay? Well, we're saying, no, that's not right. We believe the Bible is the Word of God. End of story. Not picking and choosing what we believe is part, and this is right, and that's not right. The simplest argument for inerrancy is the character of God. Once again, God cannot lie. The scripture can't be broken. And, you know, for us to be more confident in this, I'm going to try to share a couple I guess you'd say facts about the inerrancy of the Word of God to help us in that. The first is the extreme detail that the scriptures were transcribed. You had people who were Masoretes, they were Jews, and that was their job. And they took it very seriously. I won't go into all the detail of what they did and all the boxes to put the letters in and all that, but it, extremely detailed. It was taken very seriously, this job. We only had the Hebrew, we don't have a full text of the Hebrew Old Testament. The earliest one that we have is around A.D., nothing earlier than A.D. 900 in that way. But the question could be asked, how do we know the accuracy from before A.D. 900? 900 years after Christ, that's what we have. How do we know it's before? Well, you remember what was discovered in 1947? Dead Sea Scrolls. So here comes this Dead Sea Scrolls come along. They find that some Bedouin sheep herder was out there and goes, finds in this cave, finds these things that are preserved. Incredible. It says the greatest archaeological discovery in the century. They find the Dead Sea Scrolls. And they find a full book of Isaiah, portions of Isaiah, portions of mostly every single book in the Old Testament they found in Dead Sea Scrolls in 1947. And what they also found is the letters that they had, 900 AD, the Dead Sea Scrolls, which were copied by these people, the Jews who lived in Qumran. It was like, let me get my dates right, 150 before Christ to 70 years after Christ was born. This is their time frame. So we're basically having something that's 1,000 years earlier, okay? So how did those later, the ones we had originally, compare to the ones that they found? And what they found, taking Isaiah 53, 166 words, there were 17 letters that were different in the Isaiahs. 10 of those letters were spelling, like you spell a word, honor, H-O-N-O-R, H-O-N-O-U-R, Savior, same idea. They said there was 10 of those that were just spelling, didn't make any difference. 4 were conjunctions that were added, which was just kind of writing and, for, but, that were added, four of those. The 3 other letters out of the 17 created the word light, which they included in verse 11 of that passage, which just says, they shall see, and then it was inserted light. And so that was the one, those are the 3 letters that were challenging. This is the same for the whole of the manuscript. There's these minor discrepancies and difference over 1,000 years. I don't know if you've played the telephone game. You never, probably don't even do that anymore. That's like so lame, you know. But you think about something that's transferred 1,000 years down the road, down the road, down the road, down the road, and there's 17 letters that are different. Not different words, 17 letters. And they say, well, 10 of them spelling, a couple conjunctions added here, and one we're not sure about these 3, where they fit. But it didn't change the meaning of the text. And so it's important we understand this is a typical of the manuscript over the whole time, so we have great confidence. The evidence of the New Testament is incredible because we have like 6,000 manuscripts, and we have them that are like within like 100 years of when they were written, okay? And so it's when the events took place, excuse me, in that sense. And so we have great evidence that we can accept that. Now, people question that, but there's classic scriptures. Here's one example, Caesar's Gallic War, which there were 9 or 10 good manuscripts that were written 900 years after Caesar's time. And yet we have 6,000 plus manuscripts, evidence, that were written within 100, some within 100 years, some shortly after that, that show the veracity, the truthfulness of the New Testament. So we can have great confidence in the Bible you have today, that you have with you on your phone or with you in your hands, whatever, that is so close to the original manuscripts, we have great confidence saying, this is the Word of God, and I could know this. A second implication is knowing the Bible is God's Word, it's unchanging. The Bible, like God, you know, I'm the Lord, I do not change. The same is with the Word of God. In John 21:33, it says, Jesus said, heaven and earth will disappear, but my words will never disappear. My words will never disappear. Isaiah 40, verse 8, the grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of the Lord our God stands how long? Forever. Okay? The word of the God stands forever. Now, the experts, you know, things are shifting. What's the thing to do today? You know, whatever it is and whatever arena you're in, there's always this changing. What works 5 years ago doesn't work now. You know, science textbooks have an average lifespan of like 18 months, I read, because things are always changing, coming up with new ideas, new beliefs in that way. You know, here's the thing. I read this, that this was millions of baby boomers, those who were born, what was the baby boomer time? Something to 64, 46 to 54, 48 to 64. That's one out of three people in America are baby boomers. I know it's pretty shocking. But here's the thing. They were raised with their parents who had, besides the Bible, there was another book that was the book to tell you how to raise your kids. It was by Dr. Benjamin Spock. Okay, it wasn't like Spock on the thing, okay? Dr. Benjamin Spock. And he wrote this book, and it was the Bible for raising kids. And this article I read said Dr. Spock expressed his opinions about what he thought about was the proper way to raise children. Some years, it was reported later that Dr. Spock was then in his 70s. He held a press conference and said, I don't know if this is exactly how he worded it. Oops, I was wrong. That's not the best way to do it. I'm sorry, never mind. And this pastor said, all of us baby boomers are thinking, well, thanks a lot. It's a little late. We're already dysfunctional. You know, an entire generation was raised a style of parenting that studies later confirmed that didn't work. There's always things, well, you know, for diet, you should make sure you don't eat eggs because eggs are terrible for you. And it's like we find later, well, eggs are really important to eat eggs. And it's just, there's always those kinds of things. Well, what do I believe? I don't know what to believe. You know, here's the thing, the word of the Lord stands forever. It is unchanging in that way. Luke 21:33, though the heaven and earth shall pass away, my word shall remain forever. A third implication of knowing the Bible is God's word is to know that God's word is true, and therefore God's word should be our authority for how we live our lives. Okay, I want to just talk about the truthfulness of the word of God first. Jesus, in praying to God the Father in John 17:17, says, Father, make them holy by your truth. Teach them your word, which is truth. Your word is truth. That's what says the word of God. Because God's word is true, it's therefore trustworthy. Now, you may have heard the phrase, this is a phrase I've heard for quite a while, well, that's your truth, but that's not my truth. Anybody ever said that? You know, I say, oh, that's your truth. That's not my truth. I'm thinking, okay, how does that work? You know, I've had someone I've interacted with that said that, and I'm just going, okay. But see, the truth is no longer considered in that way as the same for all people, same for all time and situations. Truth is varying depending on how one feels, depending on how who maybe we've read, depending on what society says or those close to us say. That's what our truth is. And the word of God comes under that. So what is our authority then at that point is our belief system and what we think and not absolute truth and not the word of God. And absolute truth is being hammered today in the sense of set aside. And it's not just, it's just saying, well, truth is relative. You know, say, and here's the thing with relativism. It just doesn't work. So you say, well, you know, like relativism will say, first of all truth is relative. Well, if they say all truth is relative, there is no absolute truth, then relativism is also relative. And so if that makes sense, so why would you follow that? That doesn't make any sense. The other thing about relativism, they'll say, well, what's true for you may not be true for me. But, you know, so here's the thing. It's saying it doesn't work. I can say, well, I believe that God exists. And you say, well, that's truth for me. My truth is that God exists, but truth for another one says he doesn't exist. Well, how can they both be true? They can't be. Either God exists or he doesn't exist, okay? It doesn't work. Some say, well, that's your truth, that's my truth. Well, either God exists or he doesn't. You know, that's truth in that way. They don't work together. Some suggest and declare absolute truth is bigoted and narrow-minded. Well, how dare you say there's absolute truth? Well, it's the same idea if you say, well, there is no absolute truth. It's the same argument. So if you're saying, well, there is no absolute truth, well, you're just being narrow-minded by saying, well, you're telling me there's no absolute truth, but I'm telling you there is. So it doesn't work to say there's no absolute truth as being just as narrow-minded as saying there is absolute truth if you're being accused of that. For Christians, you know, the Bible is the Word of God, and it's unchanging, and it's forever in that way. It's truth from God. and therefore it's authoritative for all faith and all of life. And we can trust that what it tells us is worth believing and is worth obeying. And most of you know this, say, I know this. But here's the thing. Here's a question we need to ask ourselves. We say, all we talk about the Bible being God's word, true, it's not relative, it's absolute truth. Here's a question we need to ask, or questions. What's going to be, since we know this is true, what's going to be our authority for our lives? What's our authority? And I would urge you, don't just blow this off, because we can say, oh yeah, my authority is the Bible, but really think about it. What am I going to base my beliefs on and my behavior? What's going to be my guide? What's going to be my compass? What's going to be my today's GPS in my life that tells me my direction I'm supposed to go? And we have two options. We either hold to what the world tells us, or we hold to what the Word of God tells us. We hold to what the culture says, or what God says. We hold to the ever-changing lies, if you will, of the world that we're told all the time, as compared to the inerrant, unchanging Word of God. And that's what it comes down to, really. And so it's important for us to just really step back and say, what is it that has in my life as my authority? And again, I think as Christians so often say, well, it's the Word of God. And we step back and look at how we live. Am I living according to the Word of God? Am I doing what God has called me to do? And so it's important that we step back and ask, what is the authority in my life, realistically? Not just my church answer, but my real answer in that sense. Listen, what is it we know today? What's our number one GCR? Is we know that the Bible is God's Word. And we have two passages, 2 Timothy 3:16 and 2 Peter 1:20 and 21. And so when we take these passages and we say this is the Bible's God's authority, the Bible's authority exceeds any government demand. It exceeds any pressure from whatever it is, family or friends or society. It oversees our personal preferences so often. I'll put my preferences, my experiences as my authority over the Word of God. And we have to take our preferences and our experiences and submit them under the authority of the Word of God. Otherwise, we're living according to the ways of the world and not according to what God has. And here's the thing, authority has been attacked in our society for a long season. I don't know how many years ago, I hate to even know how long ago it was, they had the bumper sticker that said, question authority. You remember that? You ever see that? Some of you, yeah, see people who have grayer hair nodding your head. But it was like question authority. What does that mean? Well, that's the story of our day. Been for probably a couple decades now. And so the authority of parents is being undermined. The authority of teachers in schools. If you don't believe that, go volunteer in a school for a day, and I'll guarantee you, you'll see what is going on here, because the authority has been undermined. Talk to some police officers. We have police officers here in our church family, and say, how's your authority in society? And so the same is true for the Word of God. People are undermining the belief in the Word of God in that situation, and saying, well, it's culturally conditioned. And so it's for the people who choose to have that as their authority, that's their authority. But it's not for me. For me, it's not my authority. It's whatever culture you grow up in, and saying, no, that's not the case. If the Word of God is the authority, it's true, then it's true. End of story in that way. So knowing the Bible's God's Word from these passages, it's our authority, it calls us for a response. My fear is in a message like this, a lot of information, verses, okay, wonderful, great, thank you, but we don't have life changes. Anna prayed. I pray that it's not just words we pray. We're saying we leave different here than we came. And for us to do that, we have to step back and say, okay, since I know that the Bible is God's Word, how does that impact my life? And one of the things is, I've got to say, I need to be in the Word of God. I need to read the Word of God. I need to study the Word of God. I need to meditate on the Word of God in my life. I read an article, and this man said, I once was asked if I believed in the Bible, and my answer was emphatically, yes. After my response, a person asked, have you read everything in the Bible? And he said, at that point, I couldn't say that I had. And so he said, I was basing my entire life off of something I had not completely read yet. And so we say, oh, I believe the Bible. Yeah, sure. Do you know what it says? You know, are you basing your life on it, but you don't really know what it says and how it's calling you? I just wonder how many of us are in that same boat. We say, I believe the Word of God, but we're not really reading the Word of God and knowing what it says and saying, it is my authority. A second response to knowing that the Bible is God's Word is simply to obey it. I mean, that's we're called to over and over again, is to obey the Word of God. Joshua 1, 7 and 8, I shared this passage a couple weeks ago. Be careful. This is Joshua going into a new land, taking over, stepping in the shoes of Moses, his leadership, and God tells him, be careful to do what? To obey how many instructions? All. Obey all the instructions Moses gave you. Do not deviate from them. Turning either to the right or the left, then you'll be successful in everything you do. Study this book of instruction continually. Meditate on it day and night, so you'll be sure to, there's that word again, obey. We're not just studying to gain knowledge, so we obey everything written in it, all, everything. You know, we're not studying so often. I think in the church today, we study, we know, we go Bible studies, we learn more, I got its information, let me tell you, this many manuscripts, this stuff, I know that, I know this about God's Word. But the key is, am I going to obey what the Word of God tells me personally in my life? And so, you know, it's if we're saying and believing the Bible is unchanging, it is without error, it is God's authority, it's true, then what do I need to do in my life to follow it and obey it? And I'm sure there's here today, there's someone who's saying, you know what, there's someone I need to forgive. And you said, I'm not forgiving them. They gotta step to me first. Not happening, I'm going to them. That's between them and God. Your job between you and God is saying, if God's calling you to forgive, which he is, then saying, I need to take that step and obey what God's telling me. Maybe there's a thinking pattern that needs to be changed. I think a certain way. Maybe there's a belief about the Bible. There's a belief about Jesus, you know, that needs to change. Maybe there's a priority in your life. You have certain priorities, and we step back, we realize, you know, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. All these things shall be added unto you. You know, what are we supposed to put first in our life? Is just, I'm going to be a follower of Jesus. I'm going to do what he calls me to do. Where's my priorities at? How does my life line up with that? In my whole, how I spend my time, my talent, my treasure? I mean, these are questions we need to ask ourselves. We're saying the Bible's our authority. Maybe it's a relationship I need to make a change in. Could be with my spouse, could be with kids, could be with your parents, could be with a friend, a coworker, boss, whatever, that's not been right. And it's sometimes it's on us. You know, I know there's times it's been on me where, you know, I've needed to make a change. Because why? Because the Word of God has told me so, you know. And so it's important to step back and think about that. Here's our GCR number one, general Christian requirement number one, is to know this. I know the Bible is Word, is God's Word. And our two key passages, I told you I'm going to drive this home every time, is what? Is 2 Timothy 3:16 and 2 Peter 1:20 and 21. I'm going to close with all scriptures inspired by God, but also 2 Peter. Above all, you must know that no prophecy in Scripture ever came from the prophet's own understanding or from human initiative. No, those prophets were moved by the Holy Spirit, and they spoke from God. My prayer for our church family is we know the Word of God, and we study the Word of God, and we live, believe, trust, obey the Word of God, which will change our lives. God will bless us, and we'll look forward to that day when we will be with Him in that sense. I mean, that's a third response, if you will, to knowing the Word of God. It's studying it, it's obeying it, but it's also just praising and worshiping God. He has given us the Word of God so we might know how to live. Is that amazing? Yes, it is. So I'm going to pray, and then we'll press on. Father, we are grateful for your Word, and we're grateful for what it teaches us. We're grateful that it is truth, and is unchanging. It is inerrant, and it is our authority. And I pray that you would help each of us to live according to your Word, that we would give praise and thanks for the fact you've given us your word. And Lord, so today we're going to come to this table here in a minute, Lord, and it's time of considering where we're at with you and with other relationships. And Lord, I just pray that as we prepare our hearts, that Lord, you would work within us in areas where we maybe have not been following you. Maybe we've questioned the word of God and we realize today it is your word. And so, Lord, we need to live differently. So I'm just going to ask, just in the quietness of your own heart, maybe there's a commitment you need to make, thanks you need to express, action you need to say, this is what I'm going to take action on, whatever it is, just you and God for a moment as God has touched you or convicted you today. Father, we thank you again, and we pray as we continue to worship you that you would be pleased with our offering of worship. We pray in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. Everybody hear me? All right.
Yeah, before we get started with communion, why don't we go ahead? I don't know if you're like me, but I like to have a little bit of time to just prepare my heart and my mind before we take it. And so I think we're going to have a worship song as we do that.
Sorrows, Lamb of God, by his own betrayed, the sin of man and wrath of God has been on Jesus laid. Silent as he stood, behold the end.
My favorite verse ever since I was like a little tiny kid was Revelation 21:4. And I think it's always been my favorite verse because my family has known a lot of pain and a lot of loss. And it says this, and the writer is thinking of some future time. Revelation 21:4. And God shall wipe away every tear from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow, nor crying, nor pain, for the old order of things have passed away. My friends, that future that we put our faith in, that we have our hope in, was paid for with a heavy price. It was paid for by our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, when he shed his blood and he shed his body on the cross. Amen?
Amen.
These days, I think about that an awful lot and that verse. When I hear about the shootings in Texas, I hear about the war in the Ukraine, and I was just reading the other day that it sounds like Turkey and Greece are trying to start another war as if we need another war, you know? And everywhere you turn, it seems like there's so much division in our world, and there's so much brokenness in this world. But you and I know that our hope is not in this world. Our hope is symbolized right here, right? We put our hope in the faith in Jesus Christ, and that what he did on that cross was enough to give us eternal life, and that we should never, ever doubt. And that's why we do this in remembrance of him, so that we are always reminded of that price that was paid to be able to have that future that is spoken of in my favorite verse. And so this morning, we ask you that if you believe in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you are welcome to participate with us. The bread we use because that is in symbolizing his body that was shed for us and his blood that was shed for us. So with those who are coming today to help me pass out, come forward, please. All the disciples were gathered with Jesus at what we call the Last Supper. It was the Last Supper because later that night he would be arrested and the next day crucified. And Matthew writes in chapter 26, verse 26, while they were eating, Jesus took the bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, take, eat, this is my body for you. Continuing where we read before in Matthew, then he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, this is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sin. Drink it, all of you. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we have taken the elements to remind us of your sacrifice this morning. And I pray you convict us to be mindful of all you have accomplished for us on the cross and how great a love was the motivation behind it. Right now, search our hearts, Lord, and our minds. Give us courage to make right with you, and may we encourage each other to recommit our lives to your purpose and your leadership in our lives. Guide our paths and walk with us all the days of our lives. In your precious and holy name, Jesus Christ of Nazareth, amen.
Amen. We want to invite you to stand. We're going to sing one more song to close out our time this morning.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship his holy name, sing like never before, oh my soul, I'll worship your holy name. worship your holy name. And on that day when my strength is failing, the end draws near and my time has come, still my soul will sing your praise. And then forevermore,
forevermore.
Oh, bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. Worship your holy name. Oh, bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh, my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before. Oh, my soul. I'll worship your holy. Worship your holy name.
Yes, I will
worship your holy name.
Amen. Have a great week.